Video. That's live right now. Okay. All right. So I should probably hang up with you, huh? All right. Here we go. Get this puppy loaded. Look how nice you look, Marie. What's going on, everybody? My name is Matt Swinney. I'm the Global Creative Director for Rusk, and I'm here today to show you guys what I like to call my six-figure lived-in long layers. I've got my lovely model, Marie. Marie and I met at dinner the other night. She was my bartender, and I said she had just amazing hair, and I would love to cut it. And so here we are today, going in for this live. I actually asked her if we could do some content. So for you guys out there that are struggling to find content sometimes, it never hurts to ask people, if you know that you see that have cool hair and a great look, if they would mind you cutting their hair, show them your Instagram page, show them pictures of your work. But either way, it's a good way to meet new people and help people, you know, feel beautiful as they walk around the street all day. So anyway, we're gonna get started. So I'm gonna do basically a long layer technique with Marie here. I like to call it my six-figure lived-in long layers. So as you notice, her hair is dry, right? So we blow dry her hair straight. We used our straight from Rust, and we used two different sized YS Park round brushes. I like to use these because I can get the hair nice and straight, gives me a nice tug, a little bit of nice shine to it, and preps the hair the proper way. I do a lot of dry hair cutting, as you guys will see, or if you know me, you know that I do a lot of dry hair cutting. I like to cut the hair the way the hair lives. And so if I were to do this wet, go through and dry it, I'm going to spend a lot more time trying to texturize all those strong lines I put in. This way, I'm going to be able to cut the texture in the hair as we go. Because a lot of people assume texture is different than layers, but texture is actually just a form of layering, and layering can just be a form of texture, right? So, Maria, I'm going to have you stand up, okay? Like we talked about. Let me spin you around here. There we go. All right, so when we cut Marie's perimeter here, guys, you see, what I like to do is I like to have my model stand up, right? Because then it kind of puts me directly in the right place to cut her hair. I like to work basically from my eyes to my chest. I think it's really important that we put our body in the right position as we go through and, you know, do these haircuts because we want our bodies to last, right? So if we're consistently, you know, bending and doing all these like crazy yoga poses as we're trying to cut people's hair, in the end, we're the ones that are going to suffer. So coming in, just give myself a nice little partings here, section everything off. And I've got myself my nice perimeter. Now we want this first section of the perimeter to be blunt, right? I'll turn you just a little bit right there. Perfect. We want this first section to be blunt. So three things change a blunt line: tension, elevation, and over direction. Okay? And so if you guys are people who like to use your fingers when you're cutting the perimeter of somebody's hair, what you have to realize is that you're creating tension and elevation. So I like to use the wide tooth portion of my comb. You see right here? So I take the wide tooth portion of my comb, and notice how I hold my comb. I hold my comb on both sides of the comb. I don't have like a death vice grip on it. I come in here and I cut directly underneath my comb. So by cutting directly underneath the comb, you leave less room for error in the distance between the comb and the shear. And another thing I think you can notice too when we're cutting this perimeter is the spine of that comb is facing directly towards me. Okay? So if we come in and we tilt the spine of this comb up, what we're doing then is we're creating more tension on that hair. And we just talked about that. Three things that ruin a blunt line are tension, elevation, and over direction. So we take our first section. That's basically occipital to nape. Now, Marie has kind of like medium density hair. It's not crazy thick, but it's also not thin. So we got a medium density hair. So we can take that section all in one. Next section, we're going to take a diagonal section because I like to work all the back and then connect the front. Okay? So we work all the back and then we connect the front. So we comb down our next section. And we want that section to be just thick enough where we can see our previously cut guide through it. So you can kind of see the shadow of that line underneath there, okay? So we're going to come in here. And now we're going to kind of freehand this line, right? right up to the blunt line that we cut, right? So this particular section gets cut zero elevation, zero tension, right? So we're just letting that hair lay where it wants to live, right? So this section, it just lays where it wants to live. And then we come through here, and we basically just do a little chipping technique, and we chip away the line. So if you can think about it like this, when we cut that first section, we cut that first section straight. So we're basically drawing that line in with a pen. Right now, what we're doing is we're placing this line in with a pencil. It just becomes a little bit softer, not quite so strong. But that first line, you want to have strength in that, especially with long hair. Because like Marie and I were talking, she gets her hair cut maybe twice a year, right? So we really need to make sure that there's some strength underneath the texture in order to maintain her shape throughout that 6 months when she doesn't get her hair cut. And I know that a lot of you guys think, well, I need my clients to come in every so frequently so that I don't lose money. But the reality is, if Marie can come in and get her hair cut twice a year by me and it looks great every time, or at least throughout the duration of, you know, in between her visits, then what's going to end up happening is she's going to go out with her friends, and Marie's going to talk about how she gets her hair cut twice a year, and her friends are going to talk about how they get their hair cut every 8 weeks. And their friends are going to wonder why Marie's hair looks so good 4 months in and they need their hair cut every 6 weeks or 8 weeks. And so what that's going to do is going to help build your business behind the chair. All right, so this next section is basically from the round, where the head starts to round, down. Okay? Again, we just come in here following the line that we have underneath our previously cut guideline. And you'll notice as I go through here and I do this, I've got my hands in this little, like, almost like a prayer position, right? So when we're going through and we're doing these little chipping techniques, or even when we're point cutting, if we can sturdy the hand, it's a great tool to use. I feel like a lot of times I see people just come in here like this and let it go. And what happens is the tip of that shear starts moving all over the place, right? And so you start going into the hair at different angles. And so how that shear actually goes into the hair is going to determine the type of texture that you create, right? And so I want this to be soft texture, so I'm going in at just a slight diagonal, a little bit closer to parallel. If I bring this in at more of a diagonal, it's going to be a much stronger texture, okay? And so we want to make sure that we're creating even texture inside that perimeter, right? So when we come in, we just want to make sure we've got a nice hold on our shear, nice control, and you can see that every section that I go in, the angle of that blade is the same. And I think that's something that we don't necessarily pay attention to when we're going through and we're doing haircuts, especially when we're point cutting. I feel like you see a lot of this blade just kind of like flying all over the place like this, right? And as it does that, you actually create all these different types of texture on this perimeter, and so you get like thick and thin spots. And what we want to have is just a nice, evenly texturized perimeter. We're going to take our last section here, pull it over the top, give it a nice comb down. And again, something to think about too, like you'll notice when I comb, everything's slow, controlled, and my fingers are on the sides of my comb. I see a lot of people give like the comb death grip, comb super fast, and then just go in for the cut, right? So by doing that, you actually don't give yourself enough time to control the hair. So I just like to go in here ever so softly, let the hair start to live where it wants to live, and then I come in with my controlled chipping technique as we pencil in her perimeter line, not drawing it in with a pen. So the only part that was drawn in with the pen was that underneath section, just to give it that strength that we need in order for that haircut to grow out well. Okay? Next section, we just remove that hair all the way to the side. Now, this is a great technique to use behind the chair, guys, I'm telling you. So, like you, I work in the salon, right? Right now, I'm at my salon. I actually just got off an airplane this morning coming back from Denver. I taught a class in Denver at Carson & Co. Salon with my good friend Chris Jones. And we just got back from this class. I got off the airplane, came here to do the live. And that's, like you guys, I'm working behind the chair 24/7. I'm going to have you turn around, my dear, all the way. So when I come in and I cut the side, I'm going to take just a small amount of that hair from the back, okay? Basically, where the head starts to round back is where I'm taking my section from. So, and I comb that down in front, and I like to cut that on the front of Marie's hair. And so you can see right here, I've got my guideline, right? So I'm going to come in, place my comb, just a very, very slight diagonal, and then I'm just going to remove that hair. This way, what we do is we don't remove the hair that sits over the top of the ear. A lot of people take this hair right here that sits over the top of the ear too short. And by doing that, what you end up doing is creating like that business in the front, party in the back, or somebody who says, I feel like I have two haircuts, so almost like a bob in the front and then extra length in the back, right? And so what we want to do is we want to make sure that that haircut has that same strength sitting in front of the ear as it does behind the ear. We do the same thing on the other side. And then this way too, when I have Marie looking right at me here, I can actually see and make sure that my sides match up, right? So it's a nice little trick to use just to make sure that you get nice evenness on the sides so you're not stuck bringing one side shorter, then the next side shorter, so on and so forth. So we come in. Again, we work on our little chipping technique just to soften that perimeter. You can see my hands are still in that same prayer position, if you will, in that order to control that blade as it goes into the hair. All right, Marie, we're going to have you sit down, my dear. There you go. All right, so that's how we cut the perimeter. And mind you guys, this perimeter is available to you from hair that sits basically from the hairline all the way to the waist, right? So what you'll hear me talk about more is techniques than actual styles of haircuts, because I do believe that if you understand technique, you can create any haircut, right? All right, so now we're going to work on the face frame. And the way that I like to work my face frame, you can see that Marie has bangs, right? So we're going to bring that face frame from the back side, right? So we're going to bring that from the top of her fringe. I've got my small section right here. It's basically a small triangle. We're going to bring this out. And now this section determines like your entire face frame, because what we're going to do when we cut this is going to be point A. Point B is that hair that sits over the shoulder, right? Right over the top of the ear. So then we're just connecting A to B, just taking out the hair in the middle. So we don't end up cutting one side, cutting another side, then cutting the other side shorter. This side gets shorter, that side gets longer, and then it goes back and forth, and you keep on doing that kind of stuff, right? I know it's all happened to all of us before, right? Where we end up cutting one side of the face frame looks awesome, the other side we're like, eh, what happened? Cut that side shorter, so on and so forth, and by the time we're done, we got a mullet. So we're going to pick that length. You want it to fit right about there, Marie? Right there? Yeah. Right at the chin? All right. So now we have to decide, how do we cut this? So if I cut this up here, it's going to be really, really soft, right? We're going to be so soft, we're not even going to really have a line, because at this point, we're layering. We're above 90. So I'm going to comb this hair down, and I want to comb it, or I want to cut it right at about roughly a 45, and I'm going to be super parallel with my shear as my shear goes into the hair, right? So by creating that parallel movement into the hair with our point cut, we're going to create a very, very soft section, but we're also still going to have the strength because we haven't cut it up here into a layer technique. We're keeping it down around a 45. Come in. And again, just like we did on the perimeter, we're kind of like sketching with a pencil. We're not drawing with a pen. And just creating the softness that we want to achieve. So there we go. Now we've got our guidelines. So one thing that I do a little bit differently than a lot of people who cut face frames is I like to take these sections very vertically on the face frame, right? A lot of that has to do with that simple fact that I'm still really believe in kind of keeping that hair that sits directly above the ear. I know a lot of people wipe it out. So that section is going to look like this, right? So you can see that section, nice and vertical. So what's going to happen is my fingers are going to be parallel to my subsection. If I turn it like this, it'll be good for you guys to see. So I'm going to come in here. So I've got my previously cut guide right here. See that? I cut it from the top. So I'm going to comb this straight out. I'm going to rest my shear here. So now my fingers are parallel to my subsection and the shear is parallel to my fingers. And I'm going to do a slight open and close of my shear as I work myself down the hair shaft, basically connecting point A to point B. Boom. So then when we come in here, You can see we start to get this nice face frame, but we're not losing any of the length that sits right above the ear. Next section, and then this section ends at the top of the ear. So a lot of people like to take their face frame from behind the ear. I stop that face frame right above the top of the ear. Okay, so we take our next section, comb it down where it wants to live, right? Coming in, gently grab that hair using the axis of the shear, which is the sharpest point of the shear. If you don't know what the axis is where the two blades meet, right? So the two blades meet in the shear right here. Right next to that is what's going to be the sharpest part of your shear because it gets used the least. All right, so we did side one. Now we got to come in and we got to connect side two. Take our next section. You can see, nice and vertical. So how do we get this section to match the other section is one of like the biggest mysteries of haircutting, right? Because this side we go down, but then most people come up on this side, right? What we want to do here is we actually want to go down so that we're cutting in the exact same direction that we cut the other side. So that's going to look like this. We're going to come in here and go over here. So you guys can see. So we're going to come in here. Got my previously cut guide. I know I have to go to point B. I'm going to make an X with my wrists, right? You guys are watching at home. Try this. Make an X with your wrist. Drop the shear down. And boom. Look what ends up happening to that shear. That shear is vertical, just like my subsection. I can just work the axis of my blade and start to remove that hair. So this is a way where we can take each section and cut each section the same way. So we're working top down on both sides. What that's going to do, it's going to allow us to be a little bit more even with our face frames and allow a lot less of that like double checking of the face frame. Make an X, drop the shear, work that section all the way down. So when we turn it around, now we've got start of a really beautiful face frame there. All right, so now we need to start and we need to move to the layers. A lot of times what I see when I'm teaching and stuff is I see this first section, right? Take a basically a mohawk section, and then this is where people start to get crazy on it, right? And they start to take whatever angle they're trying to create with that layer pattern, right? I don't like to take that section as a mohawk section. Basically, if you were to envision this and you were to take a picture of the top of her head, it's going to look like a pizza pie, right? And the middle of that pizza is going to sit at the high point of her head. So I'm going to come in here. My first section is going to look like this. I'm going to take basically a 1-inch pie-shaped subsection. And that subsection is only going to go as low as where the head starts to round in the back. It's going to look like this. I'm going to comb it straight up. And then I am trailing the subsection right now, right? So by trailing the subsection, I'm allowing myself to put my fingers directly in the right space. I'm going to come here, comb it straight up, and I'm going to remove this hair vertically. I'm going to make sure that my shear is extremely parallel with the hair, right? Because we're trying to create maximum softness. So if I wanted this to be a stronger texture, I would have more diagonal with my shear. So a lot of times I hear stylists say things like, you know, that product really didn't give me the texture I wanted to achieve, stuff like that. When really the main question you need to ask yourself is, did you cut the style of texture you want to see, right? So if I want to see a chunky texture, product's not going to do it. I have to cut that chunky texture. I want this to be soft because I know that a couple things, like I know Marie wants to be able to do her hair when she wants to, but I know she also wants to wake up and have it look great. She's got awesome natural texture. I want her to be able to rock that natural texture as much as possible. And so by keeping these layers soft, I'm going to, in turn, allow her the longevity and the ability to wear her hair in multiple ways. A lot of durability happening with this haircut. Again, following that subsection, coming in, fingertips point straight to the ground, shears very parallel to the hair, and I just continue to work these sections all the way basically to about 1 inch from the front hairline. Okay, so we're not going to go to all the way to the hairline with this, but we're going to work ourselves to about an inch, inch and a half away from the front hairline. It depends on the density. If someone has very, very dense hair, you need to work more forward. If someone has finer hair, maybe you're going to stop an inch and a half, possibly even 2 inches back from that front section, because we did cut layers into this, essentially, when we cut a face frame, right? Like that is, that does look layered. So we're going to take our next pie-shaped subsection. Again, they only go as deep as the round, but now that we're working on Marie's right side, we want to make sure that we're in front of our subsection, right? So now we're leading our subsection, coming in, and giving her just that really nice point cut, softening up that top layer. Next section, pie-shaped subsection, comb straight up. And then we start to remove that. I think, you know, understanding like the fundamentals of hair cutting and everything will really, really, really change your life. I know a lot of young stylists out there today, their fundamental training is a little bit different than when I was in hair school back in the 90s, right? Like we were very much, you know, we were cutting graduated bobs all the time. We were doing all these different things. And I feel like now things go straight to kind of creativity, if you will, right? Like creative cutting, almost like what I'm doing now. You see people on Instagram just going to town on the hair, maybe using like a texture shear on long hair, stuff like that. If you can understand the rules, it'll allow you to break. So like at Rusk, we believe that you learn the rules like a pro so you can break them like an artist. And I think that's something that's really important. The stronger you are with your foundation, your technique, the more ability you're going to have as a stylist to then break those rules and create all these different looks you're trying to create. So that way, when, you know, you get a haircut that comes and, you know, that little 5-inch lighted rectangle comes and sits down in your chair and tells you they want this haircut, there's no stress because you've got the technique and understanding in order to take care of whatever haircut sits down in front of you. All right, so now we're going to switch. And we're basically going to work from that round to right above the occipital bone, okay? And we all know that, like, this area is typically where people have, you know, the densest amount of hair or the most amount of hair. So I'm going to comb this straight up like that. Boom, I'm going to slide my shear in. I'm working on the axis of my shear again, and you'll notice that I'm bringing that blade super parallel with the hair, right? And so by bringing that blade very parallel with the hair, what that does is that creates a really, really, really soft texture. Not to mention, I'm taking vertical sections, right? I'm taking vertical sections in my texturizing. And so if I were to take these sections horizontally and work myself up and cut into them, much stronger texture. It's almost like if you can think about cutting graduation, right? Horizontal graduation leaves the most amount of weight. Vertical graduation removes the most amount of the weight. Horizontal layering leaves the heaviest weight. Vertical layering removes the most amount of weight. It's the same thing when you texturize, and I think it's lost, right? Like people lose that in that concept of texturizing, that even how you take your section is going to determine how that texture works, right? And again, we're searching for soft texture here, so we're going to come in. I'm using the axis of my shear again, and it's a slight open and close of the blade, just like we did on the face frame. So we're not slide cutting here. I see a lot of people slide cut dry hair. The reality is if you're slide cutting dry hair, you're essentially using a razor on dry hair, right? And that's something that we tend to not want to do, especially on somebody with long hair, because this hair is going to live on Marie's head for like 5 years, 4 years, depending upon how long she gets it. And so you need to do as much as you can to take care of that hair that's sitting on top of her head, right? You'll also notice that we're using that kind of like perimeter as our guideline, right? So the perimeter becomes our guideline, not, you know, a rando guideline that we create by cutting another layer. We cut that perimeter down here. We know that all the perimeter is the same. And so that perimeter becomes the guideline. So now I say, okay, I'm going to start my open and close technique 2 inches from the ends. So then I'm going to have equal texture throughout the whole head, right? So every section then starts 2 inches from the end. Next section, slide the blade in, a slight opening close of the shear, just like that. Just so you guys understand what I'm saying, it looks like this when I'm in the hair. So I'm just going just like that, right? Just this little slight open and close is allowing me to create even texture throughout Marie's hair. All right, so now we're going to work on the other side. And again, we take these 1-inch sections, working ourselves, round of the head to the occipital bone, coming in, using that access of our shear and just going through. Boom. You know, I think a lot of people these days, right, we come in, you see, you guys watch stuff like this, you've got all your favorite people that you follow on Instagram, and a lot of young stylists coming through today, and they want this, like, massive success in a year, right? Like, it's like, you've been doing hair for a year, why am I not super busy? Why am I not super successful? Why am I not Insta famous? All these different questions start getting asked, and I think, as humans, I think we kind of overestimate what we can achieve in a year, but yet we underestimate what we can achieve in a lifetime, right? And so you have to remember that success is a marathon, not a sprint, right? And so it takes time. It takes time to be able to get to be great at these things. It takes time to be able to break the rules like an artist, because you have to, you know, you have to learn them like a pro. And so just remember, success is a marathon, not a sprint, and don't underestimate what you can achieve in a lifetime. All right, so now we worked ourselves through all those sections. We're starting to get some real nice movement back there. A lot of times this is where people stop, right? And they leave that hair from the occipital bone to nape because they figure they cut that when they cut the perimeter, however they cut that. So I'm going to give you guys a little tip. What I like to do just on that bottom section is that I'll section out 1 inch above the occipital, is where that section starts. So 1 inch above the occipital. Give myself nice clean partings so that I know what I'm working with. Clean partings are a must. Put that away. And then we're going to comb this hair directly up. And we're not going to comb it up and stand in front of each side when we comb it up. We're going to comb it up and plane it off the back. What that does is that over-directs this hair that sits on this hairline. It over-directs that a little bit. By over-directing that, we're salvaging a little bit of length. So that way we're not going to cut a tiny little, you know, frowny face in her perimeter. So it looks like this. So we're going to take her, take this section, going to comb this straight up, boom. And now I want this texture to be a little stronger. So I'm going to come in with just a little diagonal, boom, three hits, right? Just hit it three times. And what that's going to do is that's just going to finish your long layer haircut. A lot of times you see haircuts that have great layers in them, but then there's that little like sausage roll that sits on the end, right? So we're going to come in here, just hit it three times. Next section. Comb it straight up. One, two, three, four. Boom. So now we've just come in and we've softened that bottom section. We've kind of basically made a connection throughout all of our layers. Move a little bit of that hair. So now comes the fun stuff, and we actually get to work on the fringe. So we talked about it. Marie's been cutting her own fringe. So we're going to try and make that fringe just a little bit more to her liking. She likes it to be a little shorter in the middle, but likes a short fringe. Not a micro bang, but definitely, as you can tell, shorter on the fringe. We're going to take, and we're actually going to add a little bit of hair to Marie's fringe. I'll show you guys that section. A lot of times, you know, you would think, yeah, you would cut the fringe first, but the reason that I didn't cut the fringe first on her is because it's disconnected from her face frame, and so I want to make sure that that fringe gets the proper time that it deserves. And so you can see we're just going to add a little bit more. So I'm going to take my first section here. First section is going to be roughly half an inch back off the hairline. Do you like to wear it messy, or do you like them to be like more straight?
Yeah, a little messy.
A little messy. That's what I thought too. All right, so this is, I think, where a lot of people not necessarily make a mistake when they're cutting fringe, but they want to have a messy fringe, but yet a textured fringe, but they don't create the texture, right? And so you can see, I'm going to pull you guys a little closer here. So you get a little close view of this. All right, there we go. So when we come in here, we want the center part shorter, and we want this to be textured. So in order to do that, we have to create strong pieces of texture, right? So now remember, this section that we're cutting right now is underneath section, right? So we're going to just create some real strong texture pieces because this is all going to be covered by the top layers of our fringe. So this should actually look a little bit more aggressive as it's being cut, right? Like almost like a fringe that you wouldn't want to wear. But that's the whole way that we get that kind of softness underneath in order for that fringe to look really good. So come in. It's almost like if you think about like a balayage, right? Like we're creating peaks and valleys inside the fringe. So that's our first section. Now we're going to take our next section. So I take these in about half inch increments, if you will, right? Because we want to make sure that we get really nice light sectioning on these so that we can see what we're doing when it comes to the fringe. So again, we're going to come in. I like that middle part to be a little shorter. So now we just kind of like freehand that and work that as we go through. So again, just lightly combing that, cutting that very vertical, right? So we're creating that softness, we're creating that texture. So if Marie wants to put a product in order to kind of, you know, clump that texture together, it has that ability. If she just wakes up in the morning and wants to just rock them how they are, she's got that ability also. Next section. Coming in. And what ends up happening, guys, what you'll see is we just start to get this real nice natural texture to her fringe. I think people get real scared when they cut fringes, right? Like they don't want to screw up, because if you do, you're screwed. Well, I would tell you this. I would say you're better off leaving it longer and going shorter than going shorter and wishing you hadn't. So you can start a little long and then, again, just treat it like you're working with that pencil, right? Like we're sketching. We're sketching in her line. We're not drawing it in. So don't draw this like really hard line and then come in and try and texturize it after, because naturally what's going to happen if we draw that hard line and then we come in and try and texturize it after, you're going to naturally take that fringe a whole lot shorter, right? And so what we want to do is just start creating texture in that fringe immediately so that you don't end up having to come in and over, you know, make it too short by texturizing it and just taking away length. Because like we talked about earlier, texturizing is the same as layering, and layering is the same as texturizing. So if you're texturizing, you're definitely cutting off some length, right? All right, we've got to drop our last section. And again, it's just like a little tappy tap. So I just like to tap those bangs around so that those bangs fall and sit where they're going to live. Another reason why I like to do it dry is then those, you really see where those bangs want to live. So you can actually cut them where they're going to go, as opposed to when it's wet and then kind of manhandling that fringe and putting it in the place where you want it, but then all of a sudden it dries and sits in a totally different place than where you had expected it to. Next section, just come along, clean up the side, boom. And we've got ourselves just a really, really beautiful fringe, naturally texturized, so we don't have to worry about that. And it just goes and moves in the direction that we want it to. So these fringes, man, like you can't get it back after you cut it. So remember that, guys, right? Like take your time on that fringe and it will be perfect every time. But you got to make sure that you're seeing what you're doing. That's why I like to cut that dry as opposed to cutting that wet, right? You cut it wet, you're going to end up typically taking it shorter than you want to, especially if you're working on something where you're doing a little bit more of an aggressive fringe like we are today. All right, so I'm plugging my iron. So we're going to put some waves in her hair. You know, I got a good technique that I'm going to show you guys, get a nice little kind of jumpy bump at the base and then create some really nice loose waves. Now, her hair was prepped, like I told you earlier, with the straight. So we used the Rusk straight in order to get her hair. Oh, those look so good. You look great. All right. So hair was prepped with the straight. Now we're going to use a 1 1/4 Marcel iron. So I know a lot of people like to use different types of irons and spring-loaded irons and things of that nature, but I'm going to say this just in order to help you guys. And I think that, you know, we have to, as stylists, separate ourselves from beauty bloggers and things of that nature. And so if we're using spring-loaded irons, you know, unless you're using like a beach waver or something like that, but if we're using spring-loaded irons, we're not necessarily separating ourselves from the ladies that do all the beauty blogging and all that kind of stuff. And, you know, perception is reality, right? And so we want our clients to be perceiving that we can do things that, you know, that they couldn't do or that they can't find on YouTube. Because if you're not teaching your client how to do her hair, somebody on YouTube is, right? Like somebody on YouTube is teaching your client how to do her hair if you're not doing it. So I recommend that we, you know, teach our clients exactly what to do with their hair. So real quickly, I'm just going to set the iron right there and just give it a little tap. You see how we do that? Just a little tap, 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 tap. What that's going to do is that's going to give this hair at the base just a little bit of heat and allow us just to get a little bit of volume. And then I'm going to start my curl right after that tap, right? And so we just get that natural kind of like bump off the scalp, right? We just want that little natural kind of volume that happens maybe if, you know, Marie were to walk outside on a humid day and just get that little bit of kind of frothy base happening. Okay. Next section, I'm gonna come in. Again, we just rest that hair on that iron, give it that little bump. Now, two things are gonna change the way hair sits, and it's something you guys gotta remember, is heat and water, right? Like heat and water change the way the hair is sitting. And so we wanna make sure, A, that the products that we choose to put on her hair after we're done with all this are not wet products, right? We want to make sure that they have like a little bit more of a drier feel to them. Because if you're putting on, you know, you do all this work, right? We're doing all this work to get Marie to have this really beautiful style. But then we go on and we put like, say, a wet hairspray or, you know, something along those lines that has a lot of moisture content to it. What's going to end up happening is all the work that we've done is going to start to just fall, right? Whereas if we choose a product that has a little bit more of a dry finish to it, we're going to lock in the work that we did on Marie's hair as opposed to have to try and, you know, fix it. So now, once we get up here, we start to over-direct that hair up just a little bit. Give it that little tap. Start curling right after that tap. So you're looking at probably starting 1 1/4 inches down the hair shaft, so that you're able to maintain that nice little bump that you create, you know, with the iron. This section off the middle. So listen, guys, we're super excited here at Rusk. You know, we're starting our Rusk revolution. And basically what that Rusk revolution means to us is that we want to make sure that all the stylists that are connected and in our network, and even stylists who aren't necessarily in our network, but just, you know, out there in general, we want to make sure not only are you guys growing with your skill set, right? That's obviously very important. Education is key for us, but it's not just about that, right? It's not just about growing your skills. 50% of what we do is cutting hair. So I got asked this question once and I found it to be a really strong question and it made me think. And it's like, we spend a lot of time, you guys are on here watching us do this haircut for Marie, you're bettering your skills. I'm sure you guys are watching tons of different tutorials and all these different things. All great things helping your skill set. But that's only about 50% of what we do, if that, right? Like, we also have to remember that a lot of what we do is about communication. And how much time do you spend developing your communication, right? The communication between the client, that consultation, understanding, communication with your boss, communication with your business partner. All these different things make a difference, right? And we spend so much time working on our skills, but little time working on our communication. So part of our Rust Revolution is that we really want to help stylists kind of understand all the facets of what we do as a hairdresser. You know, yeah, great, I'm going to give you this technique and you might end up making more money behind the chair. That's awesome. What are you going to do with that money? Right? Are you going to buy a Gucci bag or are you going to start a 401k? Like, these are the things that I find really important. You know, I worked in a hair salon. My parents owned a hair salon for 45 years. And it was a shampoo set Friday hair salon. Awesome place. Thought I was way too cool for it at the time in the 90s, right? I wanted to be out there texturizing hair and flat ironing it until it was dead. You know, that's all I wanted to do. And, you know, my parents had this great salon, long time. And over time, what ends up happening is that, like, they stopped evolving, right? So they kind of get stuck with their clientele that they had. And, you know, they had to go out of business. And they didn't necessarily finish their career where they would have liked to finish their career. And I saw that happen. My parents are, you know, probably two of the most wonderful people on the planet. And it just hurt, it breaks my heart, right? And I just, my goal and why I personally joined Rust is because I believe that we can make a difference in people's life. And I believe that we can make sure not only do you become great at doing hair, but also you're prepared to walk away when you're ready, you know? And I think that's a really, really important part of what we do. Like, I don't want people to tell me it's time to walk away. I want to tell people I'm walking away, if that makes sense. All right, so we work the right side and we work the left side. Like I said earlier, two things change the way hair sits, right? Heat and water. And so if I were to say work radially around the head, okay? So if I worked right all the way to left, what's going to happen when I go through and I kind of, you know, finish off these curls? If I work the right side all the way to the right side is going to be cool. And then the left side is not going to be cool, right? The left side is still going to be hot. You guys can't see that. There you go. The left side is still going to be hot. And so I want to make sure that both sides have equal time, you know, to cool so that when I go through and I rake my curls are going to have a nice kind of like equal set to them. If they're not equally set, I'm going to have one side that looks really great and then I'm going to have one side that's a little bit droopy, right? And so we want to make sure that both sides of these curls get set really well. Push this back a little bit so you guys can see. So now we just work ourselves up the back, because if the back sags a little bit, that's not a big deal, right? Because that's kind of, you know, that's in fashion right now, right? That is the fashion of how wavy hair looks. So I've got my heat setting on about 400 on my iron, right? So by using my straight product, I'm able to, you know, give myself a little bit of heat protectant so I don't have to worry about how it's going to affect the hair. I don't have to worry about, you know, the iron and the heat of the iron. And also, not to mention, like, we're moving the iron, right? So we're not just setting the iron and sitting there. We're keeping the clamp opening. We're moving. So the iron's not sitting in one spot, you know, for too long. Boom. And now, however many twists you make are also going to determine, like, the amount of texture you get. So you got to remember that. So come in here. Watch how we do this. Boom. Set our base. Draw a circle with the iron. That's our twist. Slide. Round. Set our base. Draw a circle with the iron. Slide. Down. Boom. All right? So the more you twist, the more texture you create. So I'll show you one here real quick. Another thing to remember, too, like when we're going through and we're styling hair, how that hair goes into the iron is how the finish is going to be. So the nicer that that hair looks going into the iron, the nicer your finish is going to be. So I want to make sure that I get all those little tangles out before I start putting heat on it, right? Because after you put that heat on it, there's less ways to go through and kind of, you know, change or fix, you know, what we've created, right? Come in, grab our section, still using the Y-tooth portion of my comb. Boom, get that wave. And you can see, like, working at salon speed, like, you can actually get this done pretty quickly. You know, one thing that I think is extremely important to me, because working for my parents, they had two different haircut prices, right? You had, like, a combo price and you had a haircut price. The haircut price, you left without styling your hair. The combo price is you got your hair styled. So when I opened my salon at the ripe old age of 23, One of the rules we had was there was no separate prices. Everybody who left the salon got some sort of like heat tool, whether it be a round brush set, whether it be flat ironed, whether it be curled. Anybody who left the door got a full style, no matter what. Didn't matter, because that is your number one source of advertisement, right? So if I send Marie out, walking out here with wet hair, right? She's not going to be necessarily, you know, feeling her best, right? And our goal as stylists is to help our clients kind of, what I like to say, hear their theme song as they walk out, right? So it's all about hearing that theme song, whatever that theme song is. I had one client, great lady, her name's Anna, mother of two, right? She doesn't have a lot of time to do her hair. She works outside the home and works inside the home, obviously, mother of two. And she told me once, she goes, you know, every time I leave here, all I hear in my head is, who's that lady? And like, that was her theme song. Like when Anna was feeling her best, she heard that song, who's that lady? And so that became my goal at that point, to make every client feel their theme song as they're walking out of the salon. It doesn't matter if it's Tuesday at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, right? How people feel is what they remember, right? How you treat them is what they remember. The more present you are in your service with your clients, the more busy you're going to be. A lot of us tend to, you know, think about, you get that client comes, sits down in your chair. I know we do it all the time. And they're talking to you and they're trying to tell you that they want something different with their hair. They're trying to tell you that they need a change. And you're thinking to yourself, I've got 25 minutes to do your hair. My next client is sitting in the waiting room, sipping on her Starbucks, really loud, and I just don't have time for this, right? Like I know we all go through that. And so what we end up doing is just being complacent with our clients and not really hearing our clients throughout the process of that consultation or that first meeting with your client, right? And so being present with that client in that moment when they first sit down in your chair is huge, because that is going to set and determine how that whole, you know, process goes with them on that day, and determine if they continue to come back or they continue to find somebody else who possibly is going to take the time to listen to them. All right, so we're working ourselves up to the top. You can see, boom, doesn't sit on the iron that long. Slide through the ends, gives us just a little bit of polish on the end. I know a lot of people like to like leave the ends out, but I'm a firm believer that you need to polish those ends. So I like to slide those ends through the iron almost as if we were using like a flat iron or something like that, because otherwise you've got this like really great curl pattern happening inside, even if it is messy, beachy, lived in. You've got this great curl pattern left on the inside, but then on your ends, they can be frizzy or they can just look unfinished, if you will. So a great way to do that is just running the ends through the iron, treating it like a flat iron. Boom. You just get that little bit of polish that you need to have on those ends to have it match the rest of the hair. All right. So we're back on top. So now I'm going to over direct. All right. So this goes back to like old roller sets, right? Because what we're doing when we do that is we're actually creating what would be considered like a volume set, like a volume roller set or a volume pin curl set. And just by doing that, you just give that just a little bit of bump on the base so it has that kind of natural set of volume and doesn't look like you flat ironed it. So again, we just set that on there. Boom, boom. Come in, start our curls just about an inch and a half off that base because we used that base. And we've got ourselves our nice curl set. You guys can see all that. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to take just a little bit of our restyling cream right here. When I say a little bit, just a little bit, just enough to get inside the hand. Excuse me. And I'm going to just go through the hair like so. Start to section out my hair. Yeah, just a little fluff. Turn around. Play with the hair a little bit. Let that natural air get into the hair. And then you guys can see we start to get this really, really fantastic look on the lovely Marie here. It looks so good. I'm happy I got to cut your hair today, Marie. I think you're going to love it. Then we're going to use, like I said earlier, like we just like to use a dry hold hairspray. So I'm going to have you stand up for me real quick. So take a look in the mirror. It looks good, doesn't it? Yeah. You look awesome. All right, so this is Marie, everybody. She looks so good. We're going to take a little bit of our dry hairspray here. Right here. Weightless hairspray. And just kind of set in what we've done. Just the finishing details on that haircut for Marie. Let me turn around quick. You can see how fantastic Marie looks. I'm telling you right now, I think your clients would love to walk out of the salon looking like this. Have a seat, Marie. I want to thank you guys for joining us today. My name is Matt Sweeney. Check me out at matt.sweeney on Instagram. If you guys want maybe a head sheet of this haircut, I do have them available. I make head sheets for all the haircuts that I do. If you have any questions, I'm here to answer your questions. If you're interested in some of the stuff I talked about and joining the Rusk Revolution, you know, hit me up. I can point you in the right direction. If you think that, you know, not only becoming a great hairstylist, but also a great communicator, being a stable, you know, having a stable income and a stable life and understanding what to do with that money and meeting wonderful people and joining something that's going to be quite special, please hit me up. I'll point you in the right direction. Thanks, Cosmoprof, for having me. And I look forward to seeing you next time.